Hi everyone. Today we're going to be talking about open source, how it started, where it's going, what happened in the meantime, and I'm going to be the person who's doing the talking. My name is Nata and I'm one of the team members of the Technological Research and Development Unit at MacPaw. Let's start. We are going to wind back to about 70 years ago and go to the 1950s post-World War II world where computational power starts slightly becoming affordable for research institutions, for public and private ones, and they start using them for big global projects such as aerospace research and defense projects, which were very hot topics back in the day. And the deal that was in place in 1950s is that you didn't get your nice piece of hardware as we are getting it now. You basically rented a mainframe computer, which meant you needed to have a whole floor at a building where the manufacturer would ship boxes that you would assemble yourself. And then you just needed to turn it on and write all the software from scratch. So since there was no solution other than that, that's what people were actually doing. So they were writing the software, editing the software together, sharing it between themselves, sharing hacks and fixes and everything. So it was a very joyous and vibrant collaborative development process. If we are going to look at this from the legal point of perspective, that was basically public domain property. So there was no legal mechanism to even define what software and software engineering is. So everything was public domain. Everybody was using it at their convenience and as they needed it. And for the next decade, the things remained more or less the same. If we fast forward to 1960, to the Apollo 11 era mission, which brought us as a species to the moon, thanks to the efforts of Margaret Hamilton at NASA and her team. That's basically when we started using the term of software engineering that she introduced. Here in the picture, you can see her standing with a pile of code that she wrote for that space mission. And all of this code is public domain still. This picture is also public domain, so everything is still public and everyone can use and share it. However, software becomes more and more complicated from doing some arithmetic calculations in the 1950s to actually launching a spacecraft onto a controlled orbit and getting back. It's two very different worlds. And the costs of developing more sophisticated software are starting to rise and start overshadowing the costs that people are pouring into the research and development of hardware, which runs this actual software. And the problem continues all the way to the mid-70s, like that. Software is getting more and more expensive, hardware is not having costs rise as fast, and there is still no control about what software is and how it should be used. So if anyone wants to commercialize their idea or their product or their software implementation of something, there is no way to do it because anyone can take it and just start using it or start even selling it. And the moment in history that actually was before and after moment is the decision of the US Commission on New Technological Uses of Copyrighted Works in the United States of America that made a ruling in 1974 that, I'm quoting, computer programs are proper subject matter of copyright. So just from the moment of that legal decision, we could start applying the same principles for a software regulation as we are applying for artworks, for written texts, and for other copyright subjects such as music, for instance. And on top of that, there were some other initial court cases that contributed to the legal framework. One of the first one was the Apple versus Franklin, where it was the first legal precedent of a lawsuit that Apple won against a manufacturer that basically was selling a copied hardware with copied software. So from this point, it becomes what we more or less know now, the era of software that's regulated by licenses, and you need to be careful about choosing the right license for using the product that you need. On the one hand, it seems fair, because if you have contributed some effort to making something, you want at least to get the credit and monetization out of it, if it is what you have made it for in the first place. However, that kind of breaks the free spirit from the 50s and 60s when everybody was doing software development together and not actually caring about how it is regulated or what they should be aware and not aware of. We are now in the world where It is not as it was about 25 years ago when everybody could just join software development efforts and do it in a very free way. And there was one person who was not quite happy with how things were evolving, and it does take just one person to make a long-lasting change. In this case, this person was Richard Stallman from MIT, who invented a legal mechanism of copyleft, and that evolved into copyleft licenses as we know them now. Those are licenses that, in contrast with traditional copyright licenses, they are focusing on protecting the freedoms of users and developers of software to how to use it, how to modify it, and how to share it. And this effort is long-lasting thanks to Richard Stallman founding an initiative, the Free Software Foundation, that oversees the practices of free software development and assures that they are there in place. And the next big moment happened almost 15 years later, in 1988. It was a very interesting moment in time because Netscape was releasing their flagship product, Netscape Navigator Browser, their browser back in the day. And they were considering to release the source code of this browser under one of the free licenses, so under the copyleft license. However, there was this whole never-ending discussion that we still have today about the term free. What does free mean? Because natural languages such as English, they are extremely ambiguous, and people needed to make the clarification that in this case, free is as in freedom, not as in free beer. And when you want to release something under a free license as a commercial company, the first thing that jumps to your mind is actually free as in free beer. So that was the time when Christian Peterson from the Foresight Institute suggested using the term open source software to focus specifically on the aspect of source code being open and not go into all this detail what free actually means. And that allowed for a very clear campaign for popularizing open software development. And the term was introduced to the community somewhat later in that year on the Free Software Summit. And after that, and some more discussions as usual, the community accepted the term and founded the open source initiative. So now what we know as free software sometimes is also known as open source software. So is it actually open? Is it free? What's the difference? When we are talking about both movements, they have very similar goals in mind. They are both focusing on protecting user rights to use, study, modify, improve, and publish the software. However, the publishing the software part is the key freedom that has very strong implications. Because what happens with software released under a copyleft license is that the key goal here is to preserve the freedom of the software. So often the situation is that when there is a component of software licensed under a free license, and then there is a bigger software piece that's using this component, the license of the bigger piece has to be adjusted to not make the license of the component less free. This is known as a virus effect of the license, and copyleft licenses are sometimes even called virus licenses because they basically trigger everything that is using them to also become free. And the initial idea behind this was that we need to assure that we are having more and more free software and not less of it. However, this also is one of the factors why people refuse to actually license their software as free, because not everyone is happy with granting all set of permissions to the users if they're just using one particular free component in their software. You can see more details about how the open and free match between themselves in this nice diagram prepared by gno.org. So there have been more discussions about how we should be using and applying the licenses and where it's all going, and the compromise that the community has reached was using permissive licenses. On the chart here, courtesy of SNCC, we have a bunch of licenses, both copyleft and permissive, and you can see some specific rights where they differ. So for instance, they differ in patent use, but not all of them also require to disclose the source. not all of them require preserving the same license and so on. So those are technical details, but those are quite important when you're distributing commercial software, and those actually enable people to use some open source components in their closed source or partially closed source solutions. So in the end, it's a win-win situation that we are working with now and the best compromise that community has reached. So now, since we are fine with open source existing, we understand more or less what are the licensing peculiarities. We need also to talk about why, in principle, what open source brings to the table. There are several pros and cons, quite strong each of them. On the positive sides, the most important thing about open source is that it allows to build a community around the product. So it allows to grow a set of people, not just as a set of people, but as a connected network. And those people have usually aligned goals. They are interested in the same project. They want to see it improve and grow and contribute to it voluntarily. So this, in addition to just building a social circle around the product, results also in more ideas being tried out and the product becoming more and more innovative. So that's a benefit for everyone. Another aspect that's also very important these days and brings a lot of attention is that open source allows to advocate for transparency and security of software products, since the source is actually open. Everybody can inspect it and see if there are any suspicious malicious behaviors or any backdoors embedded in software, and then decide and make a more informed decision whether they are happy or not happy to use some specific product or argue for it and its use. And last argument in favor of open source software practices is the reliability of this approach, because it allows to have simultaneously a lot of copies of the same thing, and they are mostly synchronized between themselves. And apart from that, a lot of people are trying the product and they are contributing to evaluating it and testing it under different scenarios. So once again, that contributes to software becoming better. However, some of the drawbacks of the open source approach are the convenience of the software, since this is not a product that's being developed by a dedicated company or a team. It's people who are working on their free time as volunteers most often. It's not realistic to expect that those people will actually be dedicating full time to the development of the product. So support resources are quite limited. Development resources are quite limited as well. It might take longer. And one of the factors that is also quite important for many people is the convenience of the software, because once again, as the teams are composed of volunteers, they might not be heterogeneous enough, and it, for instance, might be an only developer team that don't actually focus enough on user experience, and then users are finding it hard to learn how to use the actual piece of software. So those factors usually play a role, but pros usually outweigh the cons, and as of now, we ended up at the situation where internet, something that most of us use on a daily basis, is functioning up to 90% thanks to the open source software. And open source solutions, they are present on all levels, high and low, so you can look at open source solutions in data transfer protocols. There are open source operating systems, programming languages are also open sourced with libraries and components for them. And of course, there is a lot of client applications that we are all familiar with, messengers, browsers, and whatnot. Open source is not only working on planet Earth like us, it also goes all the way into space, and it has already been on Mars. In the beginning of this decade, a lot of open source solutions were used to power the Mars 2020 helicopter mission, and on GitHub there is actually a special page for developers that have contributed to the open source products that powered that mission. And it's not only space agencies and research institutions or smaller developer communities that are using open source, it's actually everyone, including the big tech companies. Many of them are contributing to it quite systematically. If we look at the fresh data from this year, from January, from opensourceindex.io, we can see that there are hundreds of people from big tech companies making noticeable efforts in contributing to open source solutions while being employed full time. And if we take into account geography and talk about Ukraine, well, open source is quite thriving here. Since, for instance, since 2017, the annual Hacktoberfest challenge had a local meetup community here in Ukraine, in Lviv. Unfortunately, it didn't happen last year, 2022, when the Russian invasion started. But in 2022, a lot of people actually entered the open source communities to contribute to anti-war initiatives, and the link to those you can find on the slide. And it's not just regular people interested in open source, driven by whatever motivation they have. It's also business. For instance, service companies have already quite strong efforts by themselves or with partnerships with other companies to develop open source solutions and promote them. And MacPaw, as a product company, is also joining and contributing to this trend. As of now, we have 90 public repositories on GitHub, and I would like to briefly mention the three solutions that we are most happy with. One of them is Together Up, something that we developed in the connection to the Russian invasion last year. It's a solution that allows us to make sure that everyone in the company is safe at the moment and can keep working under safe circumstances. We really hope that you don't need it, but just in case, you know where to find it, maybe just for inspiration. As we keep practicing what we preach, we have two open source solutions that we are using in our products. One of them is the library for OpenAI API access that we have contributed to the Swift community. And another one is our internal library that we have made public, the FMP feedback form that allows us to easily integrate a user feedback form to any macOS app just like this. So that's about it. Stay with us and follow the link at the QR code to learn more about MacPaw and our open source initiatives.